Hi, this is Professor Jin Mei Chin at California State University, Long Beach. In this video lesson today, we'll look at how to solve linear and nonlinear inequalities, as well as modeling with inequalities. Well, inequalities, just like equations, are used to describe certain relationships. For example, the equation 2x plus 1 equals 5 has a single solution x equals 2 that satisfies the equation. On the other hand, the inequality 2x plus 1 is greater than or equal to 5, with many solutions that satisfy it. Think of some x values that actually will satisfy this inequality. Yeah, there are many of them. For example, if you let x be 2, then certainly 2 times 2 plus 1 is greater than or equal to 5. Or 3, 2 times 3 plus 1 is equal to 7, which is certainly greater than 5. 3.1, 4, 5, and so on. Hopefully you can see that there are many, many, many solutions that actually work. In fact, there are infinitely many solutions to this inequality. So this is actually more convenient to use set notation or interval notation to describe the solutions. Let's look at how we do that in a more systematic way in the following example. Here, we're going to solve that inequality that was given earlier using algebraic manipulations. Well, the way we treat or solve inequalities is very similar to the way we treat or solve equalities or equations. We apply the same sort of algebraic operations to it, except maybe a few exceptions. Namely, when we multiply or divide a negative number, we need to switch the direction of the inequalities. Otherwise, everything else seems the same. Here, I'm going to try to isolate the x values by getting rid of the 1 on the left-hand side first. The opposite operation to addition and subtractions. On the left-hand side, I had a plus 1 here. I'm going to do the opposite to get rid of it. I'm going to minus 1 both sides. On the left-hand side, I still have the 2x left, but now the number 1 is gone. On the right-hand side, I have 5 minus 1, which gives me 4. This operation here does not change the direction of the inequality. The next operation I'm going to do is to undo the multiplication on the x. On the left hand side, I have 2 times x. The opposite operation of multiplication is division. So to get rid of the 2, I'm going to divide it by 2 both sides. This leaves me simply just x on the left hand side and the number 2 on the right hand side. Again, this operation does not change the direction of the inequality. So the solution set to this inequality is a set of all x values such that x is greater than or equal to 2. In the interval notation, we would describe this as the set with the closed bracket on the left, starting with the 2, all the way to infinity, and ends with the open bracket. Graphically, this corresponds to the set from 2 to infinity on the real number line, where we shade everything to the right of the solid point 2. Remember that exception that I mentioned earlier about the one thing that would change the direction of the inequality sign? Is when we multiply or divide by a negative number? Well, let's look at this example here. If I wanted to solve the inequality, negative 3x is less than 6. If I simply just divide it by negative 3, which is like the opposite operation to multiplication by negative 3, on both sides, we'll simply get x on the left, and 6 divided by negative 3 is negative 2 on the right. Remember, this is a division by a negative number, therefore we need to switch the direction to make it a greater than 9. If you want, you can actually avoid doing a multiplication or division by a negative number altogether by switching things around a little bit. So instead, if we start with the inequality negative 3x is less than 6, I can add 3x both sides. The left-hand side becomes 0, and the right-hand side becomes 3x plus 6. And then to get rid of the 6 on the right-hand side, I would subtract by 6. Left-hand side now has negative 6, and the right-hand side is just 3x. This way, I have gotten rid of the negative sign in front of the 3. Now, if I divide it by the positive number 3, both sides, I do not have to change the direction of the inequality. So I would just get negative 2 less than x. So either way, you actually get the same thing. It's just the way I write it is a little bit differently. Well, negative 2 is less than x can be rewritten as x greater than negative 2. It's exactly the same thing. You basically just switch kind of the direction, the way you look at it. Solve a pair of inequalities simultaneously is just as simple as before. For example, if you want to solve the inequality negative 1 less than 2x minus 5, which is in turn less than 7, we just apply the same operations to every single thing. I want to get rid of the negative 5 in the middle, so I'm going to add 5 to every single part of my inequality. That gives me 4 on the very, very left end, and 2x in the middle, and 12 to the right end. That operation does not change the direction of the inequality anywhere. And to get rid of the 2 in front of the 2x, I would just divide it by 2 throughout. And that gives me 2 less than x, less than 6. The solution to this inequality is a set of all x values that is between 2 and 6 exclusively on the endpoints. In terms of integral notations, I would write this as 2, 6 on both ends. I have open bracket. For solving nonlinear inequalities, we need a little bit more work. This involves some sort of a point testing. Let me illustrate with an example next. We wanted to solve the inequality x squared less than or equal to 5x minus 6. Well, this is actually a quadratic inequality. The way we do this is treating it similar to how we would solve an equation that involves a quadratic terms. So namely solving a quadratic equation. So all the normal strategies that you apply to solving quadratic equations, such as factoring, setting it equal to 0, still applies here. So my first step is to move everything to the left-hand side, or to the left side of the inequality, and is setting it equal to 0. So that is x squared minus 5x and plus 6, which is then less than or equal to 0. Right? This is equivalent to subtracting 5x both sides and then add 6 both sides. So if you actually just kind of ignore the less than sign for a moment and think this as the equation x squared minus 5x plus 6 equals 0, then solving for the x in such equation should be straightforward as factoring and setting each factor equal to 0. In terms of solving it as an inequality, we're going to still factor first, but we're going to do something different afterwards. We now factor this, looking for factors that multiply to 6 and add to negative 5. Well, that's 2 and 3 is going to work, because 2 times 3 is 6, but I need to add it to negative 5, so I need to put negative signs in front of both of them. Still, negative 2 times negative 3 is still 6, but now negative 2 plus negative 3 is indeed negative 5. So that gives me the two factors that I want, which is x minus 2 and x minus 3. I want this to be less than or equal to 0. I'm looking for x values that actually satisfies this inequality. Well, let's just say for a moment that I'm not sure where I'm going to go next. Well, let's ask yourself the questions. Pick any number you want out of your hat and put it into this inequality in the place for x. Would that number satisfy this inequality? Okay, I'm going to pick 1. So if x is equal to 1 here, 1 minus 2 times 1 minus 3, well, I don't really care what the number is. All I care about is whether or not this comes out to be positive or negative, right? Because that's all I care about. 1 minus 2, well, that's obviously a negative number. 1 minus 3, obviously also a negative number. Now, if you take a negative number and then times another negative number, what do you get? Yeah, you get a positive number, right? So the result of doing a negative times negative is a positive number. Well, is this positive number ever going to be less than or equal to 0? The answer is no. This can't possibly be true. All right, so that means your solution set cannot contain number 1. So you want a systematic way of figuring out all the possible x's. That actually would make this statement true. This is how you do it systematically. Well, first of all, draw a number line. You're going to first identify the x values that will make this equation true when you set this equal to 0. So if you were to set that equal to 0 and then solve for the x values, well, apparently that would be x equals 2 and x equals 3. We're going to label those two points on the real number line here. And I'm going to pick test points to the left, middle, and to the right of these numbers. Any number you want. Well, I'm going to pick 0, that is to the left of 2. I'm going to pick 2.5, that is in between 2 and 3. I'm going to pick 10, that's to the right of 3, because I want something that's just more obvious and more dramatic. Then we're going to do this similar thing we did before, do this testing strategy, okay? So if you take the number 0 and then put it into this inequality here in place for x. We're going to get 0 minus 2 times 0 minus 3. Well, is that a positive or a negative number? Well, that's negative times a negative. And that result is a positive quantity. Well, is positive number ever going to be less than or equal to 0? No. Right, so this is actually a false. So any number you pick to the left of 2 will actually give you a false statement, which means our solution set cannot be any number to the left of 2. Well, let's look at 10, for example. Put 10 into my inequality, I would get 10 minus 2 times 10 minus 3. Well, 10 minus 2 is positive, and 10 minus 3 is also positive. Now you have a positive times a positive. Well, that result is also a positive number. And again, that is definitely not less than or equal to 0. Also false here. So that means any number to the right of 3 will make that a false statement, which means it cannot be a solution to the inequality. Now it leaves our only candidates, 2.5. Well, let's check 2.5. If I put 2.5 in my inequality in the place for x, 2.5 minus 2 and 2.5 minus 3, I would get positive here and negative there. Well, now positive number times a negative number here gives you a negative quantity. Certainly is less than 0. In fact, any number you pick in between 2 and 3, including 2 and 3, would satisfy this inequality. Because, for example, if you actually pick 2, this point right here, into your inequality, you would get 2 minus 2, which is 0, times 2 minus negative 3. Well, 0 times anything is still 0, right? So you get an inequality that's 0 less than or equal to 0. That certainly is a true statement. Okay, so that means your solution set is actually everything in between 2 and 3, including the endpoints 2 and 3. Okay, so that means our solution set in our interval notation would be 2, 3 in a close bracket. Or in the set builder notation, this would be the set of all x such that x is greater than or equal to 2 and less than or equal to 3. Next, we're going to look at an example where we try to model a real-life scenario with inequalities. Well, in this example, we have two competing taxi cab companies which take passengers around the city. Company A charges $4 as a base rate, and for each additional mile, it charges $2.50. Company B charges $2 as a base rate, and for each additional mile, it charges $3. The question we want to think about is, which deal is better? To answer this question, we need to compare the cost, because that's what better means in this sense. Well, the cost actually depends on the distance traveled. Let's try to model the cost as a function of distance for each company. Company A, the cost function, which is a function of the distance, D, is equal to the base rate, that's the $4. If you didn't even go anywhere, if you're simply sitting in a taxi cab and not gone anywhere, you would have paid $4. That's the fixed cost. For each additional mile, you're going to pay $2.50. So there must be a function in terms of the mile. So that's going to be 2.5 times D, where D stands for the miles traveled. Again, the 4 here is the fixed cost, and the 2.5 times D is what we call the variable cost, because that's actually changing depending on how much we've traveled. Try to write a similar equation for company B. If you do it right, you should get the cost for the company B in terms of distance is 2 plus 3 times D. Now think for a moment here. Which one is more expensive in the beginning, and why? Clearly, company A is more expensive than the company B in the beginning, because when D is equal to 0, that is when you haven't traveled anywhere, you would have paid $4 for company A, but only $2 for company B. That's why company A is more expensive in the beginning. But what happens in the long run? Well, in the long run, it's actually cheaper to travel with company A because it is only $2.50 per mile, while company B charges $3 per mile. So in the long run, the variable cost that you pay to company B will overtake the variable cost you pay to company A. The question becomes, when does that happen? A lot of the situations where you haven't yet developed a systematic way of solving the question, you could try to come up with some toy numbers or numbers to play with just to get comfortable with this concept. So for example, we could actually get a table of values to compare the mileage traveled on the first column here and the cost that you pay to company A for the second column, the cost that you pay to company B in the third column. And we start with the 0 mile here. So in the beginning, you actually pay $4 for company A, but only $2 for company B. If you travel 1 mile, you would then pay $4 plus 2.5 times 1 mile, which gives you the $6.5 you pay to company A. For B, you would pay $2 at the fixed plus 3 times 1, which is overall the $5. To finish this table for mile 2, 3, 4, and 5, and see what you get. What did you notice? I noticed that at mile 4, that is when these two companies break even. Basically, you pay the same amount to company A as you pay to company B, which means that they're equally good or equally bad, depending on how you look at it. But prior to that, you've been paying more for company A, because 4 is certainly greater than 2, 6.5 is certainly greater than 5, 9 is certainly greater than 8, 11.5 is certainly greater than 11. But post mile 4, you start to pay more to company B. See, $17 is certainly more than $16.5. I think this trend continues on after you pass mile 5. How do you actually answer that question systematically? Well, we can actually cast this problem using an inequality. We can phrase this problem as the following. A is a better deal than B when D is a solution to the inequality, or plus 2.5D less than 2 plus 3D. Right, on the left-hand side, this is the cost to the company A, and on the right-hand side is the cost to the company B. A is going to be a better deal than B when it's cheaper. Well, if it's cheaper, that means the cost should be less. So that's why we write this inequality down. Now, to solve this inequality, you just do your algebraic operations. Well, first, let's get rid of the 2.5D on the left-hand side. So subtract 2.5D both sides. You get 4 less than 2 plus 0.5D. And then let's get rid of the 2 on the right-hand side by subtracting 2 both sides. And then we have 2 less than 0.5D. Then we divide it by 0.5 both sides. We get 4 is less than D. Well, 4 is less than D is exactly the same as saying D is greater than 4. It's just kind of like the opposite way of saying the same thing. Well, that is exactly what we figured out using this table right here. When D is equal to 4, they're actually the same, but as soon as D is greater than 4, i.e. in the mile 5, or even the 4.1 mile, or the 4.1st mile, the 4.2nd mile, and so on, as soon as you pass mile 4, company A is going to become cheaper than company B. And that's it.